Good morning. I hope I'm well.
Good morning, ma'am.
Well, there are 15 students. Anyways, we can start, right? So who was supposed to present today, which group? This was the Sahiba Wala group, right, Sahiba?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, you guys can share your PPT.
Okay, ma'am. Is it visible? Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it is visible.
Good morning, everyone. Today, my group will present on the topic red rot of sugarcane, Colletotrichum falcatum. Next slide, please. The Ascomycetes fungus, Glomerella, Tucumamanensin, Spegazini, Vaughn, Arts, and Muller is the associated pathogen. Under field conditions, only anamorphic stage of the pathogen, Colletotrichum falcatum FA went, is recorded. The fungus comes under the phylum Ascomycota, the subphylum Pezizomycotina, the class Pseudariomycetes, and family Glomerella. After describing the disease in detail with the symptoms, Wendt demonstrated the parasitism of the fungus he isolated from the diseased tissues, calling it Colletotrichum falcatum Wendt, and further carried out life history studies. Next slide, please. Color ranges from almost white through light ashy gray to dark gray, growing darker with age, pale olive gray to pearl gray, with no color or pigmentation in reverse in the medium. Hyphae are densely interwoven, anastomosing in definite ropes. Conidia develop in a pink or salmon colored water soluble mucilaginous mass, and when produced rapidly on the upper portion of the acervulus, it is covered with a shining droplet. The isolates show enormous phenotypic variation on the plates, and broadly they are grouped as light and dark isolates. However, there are intermediate types with variation for sporulation and colony characters. Several of studies studied at Coimbatore, India, were able to produce acervuli in culture with diameter ranging from 0.639 to 1.54 mm, and setae are found in all isolates, and in few cases it was rare. The number of setae ranged from 3 to 20 per acervulus, and length ranged from 20 to 220 micrometers. Conidophore length range from 120 to 330 micrometers. Next slide, please. So these are the images of the conidia of Colletotrichum falcatum. Next slide, please. Coming to the variability. So Colletotrichum and falcatum is a facultative saprophyte and keeps on changing because of mutation, heterokaryosis, and adaptation, which results in the development of new pathogenic race in nature, and it becomes a very challenging task for sugarcane breeders to develop a resistant variety against red rot pathogen. Next slide. Disease, red rot. Red rot of sugarcane was first reported as a disease in sugarcane in Java in 1893, within a decade after Wendt's description of the disease and its economic damages to sugarcane milling In Java, its occurrence were reported in several parts of the world. All the reports indicated that disease was widely spread and recognized as a new disease of sugarcane in countries like Australia, India, USA, including Hawaii and mainland, West Indies, Brazil, Mauritius, Philippines, etc. Red rot is one of the most serious diseases of sugarcane in many countries, including India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Thailand, Myanmar, Nepal, Vietnam, and other countries. Next slide. Red rot in India. In India, Dr. C.A. Barber did foundation work on the disease when it struck for the first time in the then Madras Presidency, Buttle. The imperial mycologist at the Imperial Agricultural Research Institute, Pusa Bihar, India, studied extensively on the causal organism and its portals of entry into the cane stalk based on the most distinctive feature of rotting of the internal stalk with reddish discoloration. He named the disease as red rot. Severe red rot epiphytotics in the Godavari Delta and North Indian plains caused extensive damage to sugarcane. However, this scenario resulted in the establishment of Sugarcane Breeding Institute, SBI, at Coimbatore, India in 1912 by Dr. Barber to develop red rot resistance variety through interspecific hybridization. Next slide, please. So this is an image showing the distribution of sugarcane red rot in the entire world. Next slide, please. Effect of disease. It induces conversion of sucrose into glucose and alcohol in mature cane sugar plant due to enzymatic action of pathogen. Loss in sucrose content may be as high as 33%. Juice of bad odor and not set on boiling due to conversion of sucrose into glucose. Low quality sugar as well as reduction in production. Even threats to destruct the entire crop of the field, leading to enormous loss. Next slide. Talking about the favorable conditions for the disease development. So mean temperature range from 29.4 to 31 degrees Celsius for disease development. The pH should be from 5 to 6. Drought conditions during the initial growth is favorable. High humidity is required and waterlogged conditions of the soil is favorable. Next slide. Talking about the host. So sugarcane is also one of the crops which consume large quantity of water and moisture, which plays a major role in the development of the disease in this crop plant. Red rot is one of the most dreaded disease of sugarcane, and losses due to red rot may range from 10 to 15% depending upon the cultivator's environment and pathogen strain. Red rot pathogen hydrolyzes the stored sucrose by producing the enzyme invertase, which break the sucrose molecule into glucose and fructose. As a result, the quantity of molasses increases. Besides sugarcane, isolation of Colletotrichum falciatum from sorghum and Johnson grass has also been reported. Sorghum vulgare and Sorghum helpens and Saccharum spontaneum works as collateral host for red rot pathogen. Periphyteal stage found on common grass and miscanthus in Louisiana and Taiwan respectively. However, the role of alternate host seems to be negligible. Now I would like to hand it over to Ishita.
What are the symptoms? Basically, first of all, before studying the symptoms of red rot, we have to study what symptoms actually are. What is meant by symptoms? They're the physical and the mental features, which is regarded as the indicating conditions of a disease, particularly such of a feature that is visible in any patient or in case of plants in a host. Or we can also say that it is the indication or existence of feature of or undesirable change that occurs in the host plant in response to the infection of the pathogen. Next slide. So next thing that comes to our mind is that why we consider only symptoms. We consider symptoms for the characterization of disease because symptoms are the features that can easily be occurred after the infection by the pathogen. These symptoms are considered because they are easily visible by own and can be easily classified whether the plant is suffering from disease. We can easily classify whether the plant is suffering from any disease with the help of the symptoms. They are considered because with the help of them, where how much infection, we can also determine that how much infection, which at what stage the infection is at. Next slide. Now we come at red rot symptoms. First of all, red rot is a disease which is mainly recognized by the characteristic features shown in sugarcane, which are the rotting and the reddening of stalk tissues. Reddening of stalk tissues. These symptoms can appear in any stage of crop growth, as it can appear in all life stages of a crop of sugarcane and can affect any part of the crop. It is one of the most devastating disease caused in sugar canes, which is caused by Colletotrichum falciparum. And it is one of the pathogenic strain which is very highly virulent and is responsible for varietal breakdown of sugar canes. Few main and important symptoms of red rot are symptoms in young plant, internal symptoms that are seen in sugar canes, stalk symptoms in the sugarcane, and foliar or midrib symptoms, which are mainly seen in the leaves of sugarcane. Next slide. As we can see in this, symptoms in a young plant. In first picture, there are few leaves which are yellow in color or dried leaves. This is the pre-germination death of buds and drying of germinated sprouts or shoots which are observed. Here, the germinated buds and the germinated plant die due to the drying of leaves. In the second figure, we can see a typical red spot inside the canes along with the foliage discoloration. In the lower area of the picture, there are red spots which are easily visible, which indicates the presence of red rot in the young plant. Settling shows, and somewhere there are some yellow and orange discoloration, which also leads to drying of entire shoots. In third picture, there are orange and yellow discoloration on spindle leaves, which indicates the drying of leaves and is also one of the sign of red rot infection. Next slide. The second symptom, which is seen in the stalks of the plant and is also considered as the external symptom. In the first figure, we can see that the leaves becomes yellow or orange in color, and this leads to drying of leaves and then leads to deadening of leaves, and the plant will affect it. In the second figure, we can see that in the field there are many plants which are having yellow leaves, which directly leads to crop failure. In the third picture, we can see the sugar canes which are infected and show some red color in them. This shows the infection in the internal tissues that leads to this kind of discoloration, and it can vary from brown color to red color especially on the area around the rings. In the fourth figure, we can see that there is appearance of fruiting body of fungus around the ring areas. Next slide. Third are the internal symptoms which can be seen in sugarcane. In internal symptoms, when rot appears mainly inside the stalk, It mainly inside the stalk. Here, reddening of internal tissues and white spots can be seen in the image where the sugar canes are having red and white spots consecutively. And they are usually elongated in nature and all contains and are almost all over the width of cane. If the cane are torn, then a starchy odor emits that from the affected cane, and this is also one of the symptoms which by which we can identify that the plant, that the sugarcane crop is infected from the red rot. Affected canes sometimes show longitudinal pith cavity filled with grayish mycelia. Next slide. Then comes the foliar or midrib symptoms. Foliar symptoms or the midrib symptoms are the symptoms which are basically the midrib lesions. Which are observed. In this a long lesion in the midrib can be easily observed on the leaf, which is reddish brown in color, and sometimes spots on leaf lamina can also be seen. Reddish area of sheet are also observed in this. Small brown and red spots on the upper area of leaf, as we can see in the lower image, there are few spots present on the midrib. They appear when the plant is or the crop is affected from red rot. Higher intensity of midrib lesion is observed after summer rains and during monsoon season. This means that the possibilities of getting red rot infection is more after the summer rains or during monsoon season. Next slide. Now comes the disease life cycle. As we can see in the chart, that the disease starts from the primary infection and then it leads to the complete infection inside the cell and leads to the disease buildup. First of all, the primary infection came when the red rot is came inside the cane, and it is transferred to other parts of the body, other parts of the plant body, like it leads to midrib lesion and passive transmission through the seed cane. Then the disease is transferred to different crops inside the same field, and it directly leads to contamination of the whole crop field and leads to destruction of the whole crop present in the field. In this cycle, first the midrib lesions are observed, and then in the rain or in the there is irrigation of water which leads to more stalk infection, and then disease is built up inside the plant. Now I hand over to Namrata.
Now coming to losses, the red rot disease attacks the standing sugarcane crop and thus causes enormous losses. In an epidemic form, it causes heavy reduction in stands and even threatens to wipe out the entire crop in the field. Due to enzymatic action of the pathogen, there is conversion of sucrose in the cane juice into glucose and alcohol. This loss in sucrose may be as high as 33%. Consequently, there is reduction in the recoverable sugar in the factory. Now, coming to impact of red rot on sugarcane economy. Red rot of sugarcane led to reduction in farm inputs, poor quality seed, low cane yield, poor ratoon crops, and suspending further ratoons, loss of harvestable canes, impaired juice quality, reduced baggage yield, low sugar yield, and because of this, crop losses to farmers, jaggery production units, losses sugar to mills, and due to this, loss of national GDP occurs. Now coming to management, developing resistant varieties to red rot has sustained sugarcane cultivation over a century. Hence, breeding in sugarcane revolves around red rot resistant in many Asian countries. However, other management strategies were developed time to time to manage the disease in different countries to reduce the damages caused by the disease in the field. Moreover, in many occasions, the ruling varieties failed due to varietal breakdown to C. falcatum, and alternate strategies are required to moderate the disease severity and to save the crop. There are some methods to management of red rot sugarcane. First is cultural method, second is physical method, third is chemical method, and fourth is biotechnological approaches. Coming to first method, which is cultural method, healthy cultural practices as preventive measure is always considered as a better option. Disease can be minimized by use of healthy as well as certified seeds, field sanitation, crop rotation, proper drainage facility, etc. These cultural practices have been recommended not only to reduce the inoculum from the field but also to minimize crop losses. Red rot disease is a seed borne in nature, so disease-free nursery should maintain in farm and farmer's field. In field sanitation, removal and bury of crop debris, trash, stubble, etc. is helpful and must be adopted in field prior to planting. Seed material free from disease, pests, and mixture of other varieties must be ensured. The nurseries with less than 1% of red rot infection must be deleted from the seed program. Sugarcane set exhibiting reddened cut ends, shrunken nodes, stalk borer holes, and damaged buds should be avoided. This alone will improve the 10% germination and reduce the red rot incidence. Coming to physical method, removal of the affected clumps at an early stage and soil drenching with carbendazim 50 WP, 1 gram in 1 liter of water. The cut ends and entire set should be dipped in a fungicide solution such as 1% Bordeaux mixture. If the disease is noticed in the field, the leaves and canes should be collected and destroyed by burning. Coming to the third method, chemical method, adopt set treatment with carbendazim before planting. Carbendazim 50 WP 0.5 gram in 1 liter of water or carbendazim 25 DS 1 gram in 1 liter of water along with 2.5 gram of urea in 250 liter of water. Use fungi toxic chemicals like bevacizumab, benomyl, topsin and aeriton at 0.1% for 18 minutes and 52 degrees Celsius for dipping sets, which gave almost complete elimination of rot infection. Coming to biotechnological approaches, nowadays biotechnology play a pivotal role for the improvement of sugarcane varieties. Biotechnological approaches include cell and tissue culture, introduction of red rot resistant genes into commercial cultivars, molecular tools for detection of red rot fungus, development of genetic maps using molecular marker and molecular characterization, etc. for sugarcane improvement. Nowadays, molecular marker become an effective tool which aid the plant breeder in improving the genetic makeup of sugarcane varieties. Coming to conclusion, among fungal disease of sugarcane, red rot is the most devastating and threatening disease mostly prevailing in India. The pathogen attacks sucrose accumulating parenchyma cells of cane stalk, leading to severe losses in cane yield and sugar recovery. Incipient dormant infection of pathogen, abiotic stress, waterlogged situation and variability are the important factors for red rot epidemic. As the fungus is highly variable in nature, hence it causes frequent outbreak of red rot resistant varieties. There is different management approaches, that is cultural control, use of resistant varieties, physical control, biological control, chemical control, biotechnological approaches, etc. for management of red rot disease. But every approach has its limitation. For management of red rot disease, seed treatment is the good option, but the pathogen can also spread through irrigation water in the field. Due to variable nature of pathogen, the resistant varieties become susceptible to new rays of pathogen. Nowadays, molecular diagnostic tools are available for precise as well rapid detection of pathogen. But these molecular tools are not easily accessible to the farmers. Due to health hazards, few effective fungicides were banned. Rather than relying upon the single method, integration of all the controlling method is the best option. This is the end of our PPT. Thank you.
Okay, Namrata, my first question is for you. You mentioned about, please take some water.
Yeah.
Yeah. So my question is to you that you mentioned about molecular markers. Can you just tell me that what are these molecular markers? Or anyone from your group?
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Ma'am, a molecular marker is a marker which contain a sample taken from an organism or other.
So how molecular markers can be used in the disease management? You said, na, we can use molecular markers in the management of
yes, yes.
So how we can do that? Okay, fine. Okay, so my other question was, is for Ishita. Ishita, you mentioned a term called, there was a term which you mentioned, which is called as a heteriosis. Heterokaryosis. What does heterokaryosis mean? You said that somewhere it in the reproduction or somewhere the variability is being introduced in the kalitotrichum due to heterokaryosis. So what does heterokaryosis mean? Yeah, this is for Ishita, I guess. She mentioned this term. See, the thumb rule of a presentation is that whatever terms you mention in your presentation, whatever terms, everything, you should know their meaning. You should know what does that mean, right? So every term, every term that you're using while you're present, either you avoid using such terms, or if you put something in your presentation, so you should know the meaning of those terms. This is a thumb rule of a PPT, right? You should be very careful. See, the PPT was exhausted, no doubt you included everything, right? It was the content was very good. I really liked that. But there was lacking another thing, references. You never mentioned anywhere. The data is definitely been taken from some papers. So you need to mention those papers or authors of those papers from where you have taken data. For example, when we talk about the losses which is being caused by any pathogen, we give a reference in the bracket that who gave that this much losses are caused. Because see, such statements are not anonymous, right? It cannot be given anonymously. So we need to know that who gave this statement. So definitely it must be on the basis of some kind of a research which is being done by some people, right? So it is important to mention. Whenever we mention losses, so in the bracket, it should always be given a reference. You see, you guys are in a sixth semester, and I guess now it's the high time that you should know when you are presenting some work. So in that, there should be a reference from where you have taken, or collectively at the end, you just send, there should be a reference slide, right? Or a bibliography slide that where you'll mention that which all were the people whose work you have quoted in your presentation. So that is important. Another thing is that, there were three students who presented, Namrata, Ishita, and there was the first one was Sahiba. So I found only in case of Ishita's presentation that she was actually not reading the whole and presenting. She was making her own, converting it into her own words, and then she was presenting, right? So second rule of a presentation is always don't read just directly whatever you've written. That writing should be for a reference purpose only, and you should be able to speak more than whatever is being written there, or just write less. Just give the points and rest you speak for yourself. So this is another point that in the presentation, you're not supposed to read just whatever it is being written in the slides and that's it. No, this is not considered very right when you're presenting. So in this case, I only found Ishita doing some efforts, but Sahiba and Namrita, you were just reading from the slides. So, which is again, not a very positive point, right? And okay, fine. Okay, this is open for the discussion by the other groups also. So people from other groups can come forward and ask the question. Yes, Nehal, tell me your group also while you speak.
Ma'am, I'm from group third.
Okay, Nehal is from group third. Fine.
So my question is, how this disease, this red rot of sugarcane, is spread?
Yes.
Okay, the primary transmission of this disease is through soil and diseased sets, while the secondary transmission of this disease is through air, rain, soil splash.
Okay, fine, good. Yes, Yuvraj.
Ma'am, my question is, why does Colectotrichum?
Your group, Yuvraj, first your group, because I need to write that.
I belong to group 2, ma'am.
Group 2, okay, fine.
Ma'am, why does Colectotrichum feltum mainly affects the sugarcane only?
Sugarcane is also one of the crops which consume large quantity of water, and moisture play a very important major role in the development of disease in the crop plant.
I had one more question.
Yeah.
Ma'am, the way Ishita explained about the symptoms, can she probably is infection that can be seen?
You are not audible, Yuvraj. At least not to me.
Ma'am, Ishita explained in a slide about the symptoms. So, mm-hmm. can she enlist some of the infection seen?
Can she enlist infection what?
Yeah, ma'am. Can she enlist some of the infections which can be seen in them?
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, from the midrib symptoms, we can enlist in one of the infection that which is seen in the leaves, the midrib infection in the leaves. In the nodal areas, the infection in the nodes, we can see the infection in the nodal areas. We can also see the stalk infection when it is there in the sugarcane fruit.
Mm-hmm.
Ma'am, that's it.
Infection was in this case. The yeah, there is everywhere, right? The infection is thought to be established when we see symptoms. So definitely from the leaves to the stalks and also to the canes, it is going everywhere, right? Inside, even it is rotting the canes also. So those canes are either they are not fit for the human consumption, or their taste is not very good, and the sugar, the way it is being converted into the glucose, so it is not being, but somewhere you mentioned that it is being converted into alcohol also. So is this a good point, or can this be exploited in alcohol production somewhere? I don't know, I'm just asking.
Because
Ishita, go on.
Sorry, but I didn't mention it, but it's not good to use such kind of sugar canes in alcohol production, because somehow or the other it will infect the one who is consuming that, not majorly, but in some points, in the short term also, but they'll infect us, they'll harm us somehow or the other.
I don't think so
it's good to use.
I agree with you to some extent that some fungal and bacterial pathogens, they produce certain kind of toxins, and those toxins are actually not very good for the human consumption, right? So yes, from that point of view, it could be right somewhere, right? But then sugarcane is definitely being used for the production of alcohols in many ways, I'm not wrong, right? It is as a bioproduct or as some other things, these alcohols are in some form being, they are extracted from the sugarcane, if I'm not wrong, right? So I don't know, I'm just asking, it's just a, you know, out of curiosity, that if alcohol production, see, these days, the various forms of alcohols or methanol or other forms, they are being used as a biofuels also. And sugarcane, if I'm not wrong, the sugarcane is a biofuel crop also. So I don't know if somewhere there it could be useful or not. Maybe we'll have to study that more, right? Okay, fine. Yes, other groups, we have questions from only two groups. Group two and...
Ma'am, I have a question from...
yes, Shivani.
For Ishita.
Shivani, so, which group you are?
Ma'am, group five.
Group five, okay.
So Ishita, can you please explain this cycle that you explained again?
That was not visible to me also, actually. The cycle, it was very small.
Yes, ma'am, I'll explain it once again. Basically, that was the disease cycle, or the, we can say it was the life cycle. And in that cycle, it starts
can you
from
just,
the conidia.
Okay, Ishita, just can you just... can you just enlarge it to certain other extent, because I'm actually not able to see it. Just escape that mode, the presentation mode, and then just enlarge it. Iska wo badhao. Percentage badhaoge to wo shayad badhega. Nahi, niche se wo percentage badhta hai na, wahan se 80% niche se. Increase this. Okay, fine. I don't think it's... Yeah, it is fine now. It is still better. Yes, you can explain now.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, basically, it's one of the fungal life cycle, which is associated from the spores. And here, conidia are associated. And
conidia are asexual or asexual spores? They are asexual or asexual spores? Conidia.
Ma'am, can you repeat?
Conidia are asexual spores or asexual spores? Spores which are being produced by sexual reproduction or asexual reproduction. What kind of a spores are conidia?
Ma'am, they are the asexual spores.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Can I begin?
Yeah, please.
Basically, it is associated with the spores, which are the asexual conidia. And in this cycle, the spores, they are associated with the disease. And with the help of germ tubes, they are somehow or the other, they get inside the sugarcane tissues. They can affect the sugarcane from the roots, from the leaves, or can also affect the sugarcane directly from the stalks. And in the secondary phase, there can be two types of infection. It can be they can associate from the primary organs like the roots, and they can also be associated by secondary transmission, which can done through the water. That's why we say that the main infection occurs after the rainy season or the monsoon. And in this kind of cycle, the disease basically starts from the primary infection, then leads to the secondary infection, and then completely destroys the then completely infects the whole plant, and mainly to the sugarcane stalks, which are the fruiting part of the crop.
Yes, I can't hear anything. Is that all?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Okay. See, this presentation was very elaborated, and from the examination point of view, See, since this is the part of your fifth or sixth module also, right? So this presentation you all should have for your as a notes purposes, right? For exam, from the examination point of view, you don't require this much detail for sure, right? This is not this was a detailed presentation which is required for a evaluation purposes, for a mark, for a presentation, but for examination point of view, this is too elaborated, right? For examination point of view, you need to know about the pathogen, you need to know about the host, you need to know about the distribution, symptoms, disease cycle, and management. So not in this much detail, but for the reference purpose, it is definitely good that every kind of a detail was being given here. And though I still lack the distribution part, they said India, but in India, which part of India this kind of a disease is formed, or this pathogen is impacting sugarcane. So that point was missing somewhere, which you should have included. And for others, please, from the next week onwards, those who will be giving presentation, make sure the points which I have said that you should be including those points in your presentation. It is very important, right? The references, you should not be reading the slides, the second point. And in slide, whatever you have written, is that, if that, but whatever, you should know its meaning, right? Whatever questions people ask, and this you should remember while you're presenting somewhere else also, right? Because people don't know anything, right? When you're going to present, definitely people know about things, the basic idea, but you are the presenter, so you know majorly. So presentation mein utni hi cheeze dalo jitni aap bata sakte ho, right? And if you put something in the presentation, some words or some different words, because people are definitely going to ask from the presentation that or what they are seeing, right? Maine aapko dekha, maine koi alag se question nahi pucha. I just saw whatever you've written and I just picked the words from there, right? So you should be knowing those words. You should know the meaning of those things. So that is why, see, what happens when there is a paper presentation also. So to present one paper, जो उसके पीछे 50 रेफरेंस होते हैं ना, हमें वो पेपर भी देखने पड़ते हैं. दिस इज नॉट एन इजी टास्क. अ प्रेजेंटेशन इज नेवर एन इजी वन. इट इज नेवर लाइक यू जो बस लिखा, जो बोल दिया, हो गया. नो, यू शुड ऑल नो व्हाट एवर यू रिटन इन द स्लाइड, व्हाट एवर यू प्रिपेयर, जो भी है आपको पता होना चाहिए, राइट? यू शुड हैव अ नॉलेज अबाउट दोज पर्टिकुलर वर्ड्स दैट यू आर यूजिंग. सो दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, राइट? सो नेक्स्ट वीक we have assignments, right? So this is assignment, today was done. Let me mark them, right? Otherwise I forget. This is done today, so I have a group. And next week is the third time. We'll have a late flight of potato by Adish, Raj and Sanjana, right? Third Feb is Sanjana, and someone else is also on the third Feb. Let me see. Yeah, Bagmo virus is infecting vegetables in India. Now, Tanvi, Vivek and Ayushi, you remember this is a broad type topic. You will find a lot of review in this, and this is important. So Bagmo virus is a journal term, and under Bagmo viruses comes a lot of viruses. So you should know how to prepare the presentation, because this is not a particular virus specific. Rather, we are talking about the genera here. And this genera is very important. It's causing a lot of tomato leaf curl, cotton leaf curl, papaya leaf curl, you name, there are lot of diseases which have been caused by Bagmo viruses, right? So make sure very carefully you make this presentation, right? This is a tricky one. This is not the direct like other people are having. So I'm sure you all are going to present this in a good way, right? Okay, so we have, and another thing, I told you to tell me, fix the date for examination for both this tissue culture also, and I want to fix the date because then they'll be overlapping, because next month you will be having lot of exams, right? So at least give me the date of a plant tissue culture and plant pathology in the February when you are going to give, so that the dates are prefixed and we don't have any overlapping. So plant tissue culture kab de rahe ho aap mujhe, first week of a Feb or second week of a Feb? Hurry up, open the calendar and see. First week to aa hi gaya hai. Next, either give me second or third week mein, like one exam in second, or third. See, let's finish it up. And we are not sure. I mean, we might open the university in the February. I mean, that could also be a thing. हो सकता है कि फरवरी में यूनिवर्सिटीज खुल भी जाएं, अभी श्योर नहीं है बिकॉज प्रैक्टिकल एग्जाम्स अभी ऑफलाइन स्टार्ट होने वाले हैं कैंपस में. सो वी आर नॉट श्योर. सो लेट्स फिक्स द डेट्स और जस्ट ओके डू वन थिंग. यू फिक्स यू अमंगस्ट योरसेल्फ्स डिसाइड द डेट्स व्हिच वांट इन अ फरवरी. डोंट कीप इट टू द लास्ट वीक बिफोर देन. उससे पहले पहले एंड लेट मी नो इन नेक्स्ट क्लास राइट दैट व्हिच डे यू वांट टू हैव योर एग्जाम्स. Written theory exams, right? Internal exams. So please do that. And Manaswini, okay. CR is a Devanshi. Devanshi, where are you?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
So Devanshi, tumhari duty hai fir, theek hai?
Ma'am, I will inform you.
Yeah, please fix both exam and inform me the date because in the last moment it becomes a mess, right? Nobody wants to give. There are a lot of exams going on and you aap log bhi bahut seriously nahi dete ho. So please, let's finish it off early, right? Okay,
ma'am.
Okay, let's take that attendance and yes, Adesh Mishra. Adesh, good morning. Are you there? Athoeva. Ayushi.
Yes, ma'am.
Sam.
Present, ma'am.
Devanshi.
Present, ma'am.
Ishita.
Present, ma'am.
Anvi Singh.
Present, ma'am.
All of you, please switch on your cameras, right? Chetesh. Chetesh, ma'am. Manaswini. Namrata.
Present, ma'am.
Present, ma'am.
Nandini. Nehal, yes. Rupal, Rupal.
Present, ma'am.
Sahiba.
Present, ma'am.
Sanjana Sharma.
Present, ma'am.
Shakti.
Present, ma'am.
Shivani.
Present, ma'am.
Anvi.
Present, ma'am.
Shakti, मैं जब तुम्हारी अटेंडेंस मार्क करती हूँ अमेज़न पे मुझे येलो दिखता है. तुम क्या हॉस्टल में?
No, ma'am. I am at my home.
No, you were earlier in the hospital because I see yellow, and yellow means leave somewhere. So, वो usually तब हमें नजर आता है जब hostel के student छुट्टी पे होते हैं या what? I don't know. I mean, I always see you yellow when I mark your attendance. Anyways,
I am on outpass, maybe.
Yeah, maybe that is the reason. Anyways. के बाद कौन है हमारे पास? शिवानी, तन्वी, विवेक, युक्ता, युवराज.
प्रेजेंट मैम.
प्रेजेंट मैम.
प्रेजेंट
प्रेजेंट मैम.
या युवराज. विवेक इज देयर. अधीश कहाँ हो? जाओ अब तो. अधीश
मैम. अधीश जस्ट
मैं तुम्हारी एब्सेंट मार्क कर दूंगी. अगर वो तुम्हें मैसेज कर सकता तो मुझे क्यों नहीं कर सकता? He must be sleeping. I am 100% sure he's sleeping.
Ma'am, I'll tell him to message on the group chat, like the MS Teams thing.
Tell him. I will not mark him. मैं बहुत दिनों से देख रही हूँ. He never says yes or no, whatever, when I take his attendance.
Ma'am, I'll tell him to send the message on the group. Is that okay?
No, it's अभी मिलना चाहिए था ना मैसेज. तब तो तुम बताओगे तो मिल जाएगा. अभी सुनाई तो दे रहा होगा ना उसे मुझे. मुझे सुन तो रहा है ना वो. अगर वो मुझे सुन रहा है तो he would have messaged me. This means he is not listening, right? Okay, guys, I'll see you tomorrow then. Thank you so much. Bye bye.